Welcome back to DreamHack Winter 2015. I'm your host, Nimsh, and I'm here with Lothar and Raven, and we have the last round for today. It's not the last round of Swiss because we have 9 total, but we have the last round for today, and then tomorrow we'll have more Swiss for you, top 16, and then on the last day we'll have the top 8. A lot of players have played, some players have failed, but a lot of players are still in the tournament.
Yeah.
And we have a change of pace for the final round because we've seen a lot of elimination rounds. We've seen a lot of players just being barely there, losing and being kind of eliminated without the chance for the top 16. But for the last round for today, we just want to see the killers, like the guys who are undefeated, the 6-0 guys, which means if they win this round, they are actually guaranteed top 16.
Yeah, they're guaranteed both top 16, and well, they can kind of chill out for tomorrow because they will be playing the last two rounds, the 8th and the 9th round tomorrow. But at the same time, they want to battle for the best result, because it's not only the bragging rights of being, you know, undefeated in Swiss at a such a huge event, but also it determines the seeds, because the first seed will play against the 16th seed. So in theory, you're playing against a player that is weaker than you.
Yeah, it's so you kind of want to be the first after all the Swiss rounds to fight versus the 16 guy who barely makes it.
Yeah, of course.
Who are the players though, Raven?
Yeah, so we're going to be casting Hoi versus Shorin. So I've not seen much of Shorin or Hoi really, but all I know about how Hoi's been doing is that his secret paladin has been absolutely dominating. I'm not exactly sure what score he's on, but last time I checked, he was like 12-0 with it.
Yeah, he lost one single game so far.
Yeah.
So
there's a deck he hasn't actually played yet.
Yeah.
If he's only lost one game. If he went onto Secret Paladin afterwards.
Yeah, that's your
standing
there's
for
a
deck,
you.
Yeah,
he's
that's
just
crazy.
He's just playing Paladin.
Actually guards a lot of information as well. Because if he's just not played the decks, then no one knows what's actually in there. So that's really a secondary layer of strength as well.
That's
Hoi
important.
Hoi was always known as a Paladin player. He was bringing it to many tournaments before, and he was really successful with it.
Yep. I mean, we all remember that at Gfinity, he switched to a certain strategy that didn't feel like... It's his standard lineup, and he failed miserably with it. And after that, he said to himself, okay, I'll just go back to my original lineup and play the class that I really love, Paladin, Druid, and Hunter, and just, you know, go with that. So that was usually his strategy, because he tried something else and he failed at that, so he didn't want to adapt to new kind of classes, right?
Yeah.
So it also builds a storyline for him, because he's now connected like one of the classes, so that's really cool. And this is why I love Last Hero Standing. I mean, I was kind of fed up with Last Hero Standing for after the first year of the tournaments in Hearthstone, but now it's everyone is like fed up with Conquest, so it's like a
everybody
loves
circle, Last Hero Standing. Yeah,
yeah, circle of hate-love relationship with the formats in tournaments, and we'll probably say the same about Last Hero Standing in about a year. So
yeah, I think it's come at a really interesting point, though, because combined with the Last Hero Standing switch, we've also got the impact that the new expansions added, which I don't know if you guys will agree, but I don't think we've seen the volume of variation in decks as there are at the moment.
We
of actual good decks. Like the actual massive variation we see from Malilock, Hanlock, people played Zoo. There's multiple different Zoo lists. There's even just a few cards different in every single Secret Paladin.
Yeah,
list.
Absolutely.
Like, there's so much variation, it's crazy.
We've seen a lot of Reno decks, and the other decks deck that we've seen, you've mentioned Malilock, and Purple, who is actually my second pair for this round, he is undefeated with his Maligos Warlock, with Brown Bronzebeard. He was basically sitting on the first table, and right now he's also, I think he's second table actually, but he still has 6-0 undefeated, and he's going to face JJ. So we will show you guys mostly the Xiaoyun versus Hoi, and then after that match finishes, we'll try to catch the ending of Purple JJ and see who of those players is actually going to advance 100%. But even if you lose right now at round 7, you still have a great chance to just advance. You just need to win one more match. And overall, you play 3 of them.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, there's a huge chance of advancing. And as the player pool gets smaller and smaller, there's a chance you will get a lot more information about your future opponents. So also the better players, I mean, the players that are better prepared for this kind of tournament might shine in those last rounds when it comes to, you know, just exhaustion factor and scouting and just deck building process in general. So looking forward to the final results for today and the two final rounds that we'll have tomorrow.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm super happy to see that some of our predictions from the very beginning. So we've mentioned that a deck builder will shine. There will be one team who brings a deck that's really good and kind of like a sleeper deck. And we see Gamers Origin with Purple and Protohype actually bringing the Malygos deck with Brown Bronzebeard. They were like at some point just table one, table two, just winning consistently. I think Purple was like 14-0 with that specific deck, which is amazing. And on the other hand, we talked about the players. And Xiao Yun, like Fordham was saying, he's kind of like a sleeper player that not many people know. But a lot of Chinese people actually know him as one of the best players in China. And here's here with 6-0, just one step.
Yeah, I mean, he backs up that claim, doesn't he, at the moment?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So
yeah, that's true.
I'm excited to see, Hoi, because I'll see what other decks he's taken and see how powerful maybe Secret Paladin can be again. But also, I've not seen any decks from Sharon. So it'd be good to see if there's, like, as we mentioned earlier, like, the sort of meta over there is very different and there's some card choices and more tech ideas. I think
we
caught the Black Knight, didn't we, in his Druid. So it's going to be really good to see the rest of his decks and see if there's anything a bit more crazy in there.
Absolutely.
We're not used to.
And we also have JJ in the whole equation. JJ is the recent winner of Seed Story Cup. And it's great to see a player who was successful in the previous tournament do really well in the next tournament, which actually has a bit of a different format because Seed Story Cup was Dusty Rescending with one ban, and we don't have the ban here.
Yeah, well, he actually won the Time to Win Invitational as well days after Seed
Story
that we cast.
We
cast that, and that was insane because it was literally he wins Seed Story. 3 days later, he wins like a 16-man Invitational.
And
the tournament was stacked, right, as well.
Yeah.
It was like
they were really good players, and he won four rounds in a row of really, really important matches, and every single match was just a matter of elimination or going through further into the bracket. So JJ is on a streak, and if he will win this tournament,
that's insane.
Did we have a situation like that a player wins three tournaments in a row?
No, I think we've only had two, right? Because Orange has won.
What about Firebot with Gefinity? That was two tournaments, right?
Yeah, that was only two.
He didn't win two in a row, I think.
Oh, yeah, right. That's also a different different thing.
But I know Orange has won two majors back to back, right?
We had Tice almost win back to back DreamHack, where he won DreamHack Bucharest.
And
then he was in the final at DreamHack Winter.
Yeah.
But like, and also, like, just so close together as well. It's not like back to back tournaments over 3 months or anything. Like, it was literally Seat Story. A couple of days later, an online invitational, and then a week later this. It's like, it's crazy. And he's proving that he can do it as well. He's just on fire at the moment.
Good mindset. He is on the roll. He knows the format. He knows his matchups. And Last Year Ascending is bringing a lot of strategy to the pool.
I think that's really shown through from JJ as well, because the Time to Win invitation was Last Hero Standing as well. And he seems to have a really strong grasp on that format and how to actually work it to his advantage. So we see him bring lineups like in Seat Story, where he played Freeze Mage and almost always started with it, which means that his opponent, if bringing Warrior, can't really start with Warrior, because then if he loses with the Warrior and he didn't start Freeze Mage, then he's in trouble because he doesn't have his like auto counter. But then he cashed in on that by bringing his own Control Warrior and then Druid as well, which then counters the Warrior that people play the Freeze Mage against. So it's really, with Last Hero Standing, you go for that 3-2 win. That's really how you should build your lineup. In terms of like counter picking, you get the first win, and then counter picking, obviously with the maths, you will win 3-2.
Absolutely.
So really interesting.
What I really like, I like to see those players being consistent. A lot of people argue that Hearthstone has some randomness involved, but if you see the same players being...
Some, yeah. That's what the high level
the same thing,
yeah, sometimes it doesn't work. But for example, I was looking at the first tables, and there was Hannibal Z2 from Romania, who just won DreamHack Cluj-Napoca as well.
Yep.
So it's great to see him. It wasn't a one-time win. He won the tournament. He played really well in the last matches, and he is here and he's performing really well as well. So Lothar, do you have any thoughts about after all those six rounds? You enjoyed the tournament in the very beginning. Is there anything else you noticed that really enjoy?
I guess I didn't change my mind at all, and I didn't notice anything else apart from the fact that, as Dark Onyx said, Hearthstone community is the best community when it comes to gaming. I have like a lot of experience in competitive gaming, not only in card games but also in esports in general, and I can confirm that like no other community is so like friendly to each other. They are not as chatty. They are just like insane kind people here hanging out, talking about cards, like just even playing friendly games in between rounds. So it's just insanely fun to see that kind of crowds gathering at DreamHack Winter. And it was very similar at BlizzCon. When that was my first time at BlizzCon this year, and I was just struck by the difference when you see an esports or just computer convention, computer games convention that gathers random crowds from different type of games, and when you see one community brought by one developer, so it was all Blizzard fans, and they.
Yeah.
If you did play StarCraft or Heroes of the Storm or Hearthstone or whatever else, but from Blizzard, everyone was just sharing the same moment with each other, and that was awesome.
It's like one big family
yeah.
of fans, and we all have the same games.
Exactly.
So it's pretty great. And I think what's really important as well is that this community is not closed. DreamHack Winter is open for everyone. You could just buy a ticket and come here and play. You didn't have to be invited. You didn't have to be qualified. And there will be more tournaments like that. We have we had DreamHack Krushnapoka, same system. You just buy the ticket, you come here, you can play, you can hang out with all the players.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also going forward with the rules set out by Blizzard, for the sort of next year, it almost eliminates invites for any tournaments that want to award BlizzCon points. As that's sort of removed from the game a little bit now, so there's going to be even more openness in these tournaments. That's going to be really interesting to see and sort of blow the scene open a little bit as well.
Absolutely. And the prize pool for this event is $40,000, which is a really big prize pool overall.
Yeah, the eight first places will get the prize pool. So from fifth to eighth place, we'll get $2,500. Then from the next two places, we'll get $5,000. Second place gets a 7.5, and the first place gets a whooping 12.5k.
That's a lot of money. And you also get the world championship points.
Yeah, and this might be even more important than the money.
We get, I think, 15 points for the first place, which is like taking first place during the month. All right, guys, but the game is ready.
And surprise, surprise, Hoist started with his Paladin.
Mm-hmm. And let's see how it did go. The turn one for Shaozhen was a secret, which was a vent into mini board. And Hoist did start with a keeper, but no secret in hand.
Yeah, I think, although it's unfortunate that the mini-bot's probably going to kill off the secret keeper here. He does have his own mini-bot, then he has Muster, or he can call in Shredder into Shredder, which is pretty strong, whereas you look at the other Paladin's hand, and it's actually pretty rough. Corkhammer's really nice, but beyond that, it just doesn't do enough. There's just Tyrion, so he really has to draw into something good. We might even see, like, trade Corkhammer again. Or, is that Seal of Champions?
Yeah, that's
so already is an interesting slant on the deck with a card. We don't normally see in Secret Paladin. So I'm already liking the list straight away.
I mean, there are some differences between metagames in different regions, of course. But at the same time, I think that a Chinese representant should probably aim in our metagame to compete,
because of the area the tournament's held at, the volume of players from this sort of rough region are going to outweigh most others.
Exactly.
Let's just see if he, has anything else. Like, if he plays Blessing of Kings as well, that's a lot of buff cards.
I wonder if he's playing also Black Knight in this specific deck.
Yeah.
He was playing Black Knight and Druid. So Druid mirrors are pretty. He's pretty favored.
Yeah, pretty swingy with it. Like we said before, actually, the Druid of the Claw being the main one you want to just get rid of. Mm-hmm. But and then on the flip side, it's an interesting one because Hoi's most popular for playing highly aggressive style. But here it's like, I'm going to put Sludge Belcher in this deck. And it's like, that doesn't just automatically go face high. What's wrong?
Well, the thing is, like, if you play Mistress Challenger behind a Sludge Belcher, that's so difficult to
yeah, what do you actually do? It's hard enough when you just Mistress Challenger on its own.
I've seen even lists, like, because most of the lists, I believe, have one Lothlep, one Sludge Belcher. Yeah. I've seen lists actually go as far as double Sludge Belcher and Lothlep.
Yeah. I think the five slot in Secret Paladin is probably the most flexible.
Yeah, the mystery slot.
Yeah, it is. Because like 6, 7, 8, we all know what goes there. And then 4, there's a lot of options. There's the option every single deck's got of Shredder because it's so powerful.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then, but even with like, we've seen a lot of Keeper of Ulderman. And there's even some other cards, and then obviously further down the line we have Mini Bot and Buster. Mm-hmm. But the five drop's actually the one really flexible.
He's playing double Shredder. No, that, I mean, yeah. double
yeah, Sludge Belcher. Belcher, yeah. I mean, look at the options as well. I mean, this the Tyrion's going to be good for Shoren later on, but the fact that this... I mean, just look at the hand. There's two Sludge Belchers. He could just coin straight into Challenger, then follow up with Sludge Belchers.
Oh, look at that. He actually attacked into the Palted Shredder to guarantee a trade next turn with either of the minions.
It'll be so it dies to a Sacrificial
Well,
not Sacrificial
knows
Pact.
That your opponent has a weapon, so he will trigger the Noble, Noble Sacrifice with the attack. So
yeah,
that's
true.
Not a factor at all. But at the same time, I think it's important to deal that damage. So,
what's the second secret though?
Avenge.
Okay, so Avenge is gonna land on something. If it's a 1-1, then Pilot Shredder can actually kill it here.
Ooh. Well, that's unfortunate.
So now the Sludge Belcher follow up's pretty nice.
Yeah, absolutely.
Obviously, Hoi's not gonna be aware there's a Seal of Champions in his hand, but the Sludge Belcher looks really nice because I think it's better to just save the coin.
Oh,
he can silence it.
Yeah, he can silence that.
Coin Shredder, right?
That's so annoying for Hoi.
Well, there's a point to silence Coin Shredder here. Because next turn he can still Challenger, and he also, that 0-7 stays on the board, and he might play Blessing of Kings, right?
Yeah,
so,
but...
Or
well,
Avenge target.
I think you don't want to do it because you are expecting Tyrion at some point, and you...
That's true.
And just looking at your opponent's hand with two cards, and then three cards after the draw, you're not that afraid. And you know that nothing is going to get played this turn.
Like, yeah, it negates your opponent's next turn, that's true.
Let me think.
So you do still possibly just play Mistress Challenger on empty board on turn 6.
Yeah. Because the problem here is as well, like we can see that Shoren's got the Seal of Champions, which is +3, right? It's
plus three.
So like he can kill the Doomsayer, but he might decide it's not worth it. Because to just kill the Doomsayer and then almost pass, because he can't really, hero power, I guess, then like he took a lot of damage, and then that mini bot's not really done much and could just get silenced or killed. And then it's suddenly like, oh, okay, block all that quickly. Sort of burst damage from the Seal of Champions. He is going to go for it, though.
Yeah, he's going for the steal. This creates a really big minion on the board that's not really contested for now.
And well, there's the silence, right?
Well, he can just play Mysterious Challenger, kill the 1-1, and then use the other 1-1 onto the minibot to prop the shield.
Oh, yeah.
So then the minibot's just going to kill itself anyway, right? And it might for sure into... Obviously, from Hoi's point of view. I knew I was going to say that. From Hoi's point, it's because we talked about it just before the cast. From Hoi's point of view, he might actually just not attack and maybe play something else, like Muster into it to create like more of an awkward turn.
Yeah, so it looks good. Like, is there anything else you can do?
I don't think so. It's turn 6, you want to play your, trademark card in your deck, right?
Yeah. And the follow, like you said, instead of playing the Challenger behind the Belcher, you can play the Challenger now. It's relatively safe, or as safe as it's really going to get, and then just follow up with Belcher, and then suddenly it's like, how does he actually get through all of this?
And also, he filtered his deck, right, with all those secrets out. So.
It improves his draws for the following turn.
So the competitive spirit will practically say to us that the minibot will not attack. And we see a pass.
Because now Hoi can just push for damage, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Especially, oh, redemption even.
But so he plays two redemptions in his deck. Interesting.
Yep.
Well, it makes sense with double Belchers. So,
yeah.
Good call.
Yeah.
This is so funny that the Belchers can actually come back here. What do you silence, though?
Dude, do you silence?
I think
juggler Belcher, right?
Let me think.
Yeah.
Because there's so much power on board. He has one card that he's had in, if Hoi's been paying attention, he's had in his hand all game. So, I don't know. I kind of like just juggler Belcher and go face at this point.
Yeah. Okay, so silence for Tyrion makes a little sense.
What if you just play juggler, shredder, coin, silence.
I think Belcher is so good because you have redemption online.
Yeah.
But there is noble sacrifice as well. So.
But if the Belcher gets the Avenge, like, that's just even harder, right?
I think if you go for the Belcher, then you have to silence the 5-2 because that definitely contests the Belcher.
Yeah, because I suppose because you leave the 1-1 up, right? So that's going to proc the initial attack. That's
exactly
true.
Alright, so he actually used the silence. He hopes there is no Tyrion, but even with Tyrion...
I think just the brute force of Hoi's minions on board which is guaranteed that he will go through that Tyrion, and the weapon will not have an impact at all because the Belchers are stopping the attacks. Wonder. Like, you know.
And next turn, you can just play Belcher Coin Shredder. It's just like.
And you have a redemption.
Get through all of these minions.
And you have a redemption for the Belcher, so it's like.
Yeah, you could just Belcher redemption. Yeah.
Well, go through a third Belcher with one HP. Well, GG.
And yeah, overall weapon is really good as minion removal, but if you are super low on health, you can't really attack at the minions.
Yeah.
So weapon gets. Is useless at some point.
Yeah, I mean, it's powerful like in a vacuum, but when you look at like board state, and then again, a good play here would just be Juggler, Belcher, and then Coin Redemption if the attack comes in from Shurin. But if not, then you know he can just pass on that, so he doesn't attack again. And this is Blessing of Kings. Okay.
Blessing of Kings is interesting because you will be able to kill Tyrion with a simple owl.
What do you use to proc though? What do you use to get rid of the shield?
Well, if you don't hit with can you juggler? You can actually juggler. and hope that you get the 6/6. But
what do you juggler with though? Because you don't have enough mana to do Blessing of Kings.
Hero power. So you juggler hero power, hit the shield.
And do it. You 100% do it.
Well, if you hit it, you will not have to attack with Belcher, so I think that's a good deal overall.
Is Holly going
to
make the play? Ooh. Okay, he's just going to play like Super Saiyan.
Now he made... it's not the full board.
At this point, do you just... Yeah, you prop the shield down, right? Kill, yeah. I was going to say, because like, if he consecrates, then the 7-1 gets redemption as a 6-1, as well as an avenge. And then if he doesn't consecrate, like attack first to proc it, then consecrates, well, what's he doing with the rest of his turn? You've still got Sludge Belchers, the avenge, Blessing of Kings for next turn, another redemption.
Yeah.
Hoy's in such a strong point. I'd be amazed if this goes against him.
Well, there's no consecrate for Shuyan, so...
Yeah, the cards that he has in his hand are practically... Not important in this situation.
Yeah. There's nothing you can even particularly get from his Shredder, even if you could turn it. So, actually.
It's maybe like a Totem Goo.
Which Totem?
Yeah, because I don't know if it'll be enough.
Like Vitality?
I don't think so.
Because plus 4, but then, like, there's still a Vengeance and Redemption down.
So he can't even kill the 7-1.
Oh, and then lands on the Juggler. How convenient.
And Redemption, then he's got Blessing of Kings, and look at, like, there's still two Sludge Belchers to fight through. And Juggles.
Even the tokens, the one thing, are pretty good.
That is just too much damage.
To the face.
Yeah, there's no way he's just dead to Mr. Changer. Well played, and Hoy actually takes game number one in the Paladin Mirror.
So Paladin Hoy is taking it again, 14-1 in games.
Not bad,
Sounds okay for a deck, I would say.
Sounds like
a
pretty reasonable deck list.
Seems like, actually, if people were searching for a deck list, because there are so many deck lists online, that's the deck list to take.
Yeah, 100%.
It probably will do that well on ladder.
Well, you can imagine after this tournament, there's Hoy's Paladin, and then there's going to be the Maliloc list. And that'll just blow. That'll just be on your side. It happens after every tournament when there's a sort of breakaway deck.
Mm-hmm. And then everyone will be playing Face Hunter.
That's
to
fine.
Counter those
is
two.
Is Face Hunter good versus them at all?
I mean, how do you counter Rena Jackson's deck? You just kill them before they play Jackson, right?
Yeah, but
With Maliloc as well, the AoE clear doesn't matter to Face Hunter, and the heal comes only really turn 5.
I like the 16 heal with Bran and, you know, and heal bot.
But look at that. Let's go back to the game. Xiongnu is... pushed to use his warrior against Paladin, which in general is not a great matchup if that's a control warrior, and I would say it is because there's two shield blocks.
Yep.
So it's really weird because his lineup is weak against Secret Paladin because he's relying his lineup on basically a mirror match between Paladins.
Maybe he has some deck cards, and he actually is 6-0 right now, and Paladin was pretty popular among the players. I would not say that he was never facing Paladins.
I never said that.
Oh, Death Lord's a card.
Yeah, this
is... Okay, so it might be a Fatigue Warrior.
Which requires a lot of patience, but should also be good versus...
This is huge. So just a note. Hoy had two secrets in his opening hand and the Secret Keeper. and he threw away the competitive spirit, understandably, because that's just not good early on. He kept the Avenge, and now he's drawn into mini boss, so that's actually really big. The Death Lord's going to shut down it for now. Maybe we see that it would... It's really tough on this. Do you even want to Owl? It's, you sort of need to, because you've got no way to kill the Death Lord. Or do you just coin out the Shredder and wait?
I guess you would like to keep the coin for the Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah.
So I might just go for the Avenge, wait a turn, and coin. I mean, sorry, Avenge, Hero Power, and wait a turn. Because that makes you in a position... That puts you in a position when the Avenge might actually matter more.
What would be a bad minion to get from Death Lord?
Nothing is bad here. Just
it's always a body you're getting.
Yeah, exactly. It doesn't
the thing
really
is as well, like if he killed it now or next turn, Dr. Boom comes out. Yeah, you don't get the battle cry. Same with Mysterious Challenger, you don't get the battle cry, but you still get 6/6 or 7/7 on board. And then you can always get Tyrion, which would just probably end the game.
Well, the Tyrion is in the hands of Hoey, so
yeah.
I wouldn't be affected, but of course.
This is such an interesting matchup. How do you guys think it's gonna actually end up? There is so much armor gain and some good removal.
I think now, though, if you look at the Secret Keeper 5/5, the minibot still got the shield. Next turn, Hoey can just play Shredder, and then the turn after he just coins into Challenger, and that's such a strong like follow-up. And I think then. It's just, there's an execute, double he's got
there
the death fight.
There might be a brawl at some point.
Yeah, sure.
Should his deck is playing two of them.
I think, regardless, this is interesting. I would have thought he wanted the death bite to be up this turn.
That's very interesting.
Because this turn he could have death bite the 2/2 and then killed it with the death orb.
Yep, that's...
Because the whirlwind effect just kills whatever, right, with the execute.
Yeah, because next turn, you would have to use execute. The situation, that's why you play the armor smith. So you plan to run the armor smith into the 5/5, that would be my guess.
Yeah. You don't have to if secret keeper. So do you kill armor smith? That's the biggest question, because armor smith is dangerous when you play versus warrior. Killing armor smith, you mostly actually do more damage over time because armor smith is gonna gain life.
Yeah.
So if secret keeper attacks into Armorsmith, then Deathbite is just going to kill it next turn.
Yeah. I guess that what he's got to weigh up is if he just drops Shredder and goes face, that's a lot of pressure. And the fact that he can follow up with Mysterious Challenger, like it's so powerful. Look at his board. Even a brawl isn't too amazing. Because I think the, I suppose the Secret Keeper come back in a brawl because it was played first. But there's still the 6/6. There's the redemption, the proc from Shredder, and then Avenge goes onto something. So even after a brawl, like, and he could win the brawl, he could get like keep the Shredder or the Secret Keeper, so there's still a lot of good outcomes even after that. So I kind of like Hoey being aggressive here.
Yeah, it's pretty good working for Hoey, but then Shuyan has actually Deathbite here that he can use on the Shredder. Probably attack. You want to execute the 5/5, right?
Yeah, it looks like he's going to use the Death Lord to execute. Which is fine, because it still survives actually. He still has one health, so that's still fine.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's more life gain because armor seems to survive.
Blessing of Kings, go face.
That was actually really smart. I like that play.
Because what's important against Secret Paladin, especially, well, mainly because of the Mysterious Challenger, is having multiple minions on the board when that card hits. Because you need to be able to proc the Secret and then have something left to do, you know, do something. Like, if someone plays Mysterious Challenger and you've got an empty side of your board, you're definitely in trouble. Because you've got no way to really proc the Secrets in at least a half positive way for yourself.
Yep, that's true.
So even the 2/1 and the Armorsmith is 1/2, still pretty nice. He's going to trade.
Alright, so for Hoey, it's still Mr. Shanger being the best player on the turn 5. Filtering the deck, a little secrets, bringing a big body on board. He still has the Shredder. So, looks alright. Second Shield Maiden.
That's not like that's gonna do much, that's the problem.
Not gonna do much now, but that is some life gain. I
can take the hit. The problem is, like, with Shield Block, if you wanted to draw, what could he draw into that would be worthwhile? I think that's the only issue. He's choosing to take the 5/5.
Now, that's the moment when he needed the execute that he already used.
Yeah, but he had to use execute as well. Secret Keeper can get out of control. And
do you just Blessing of Kings? One of these? Do you care about like one juggling and one more? Oh, Oh wow, the 1-1.
That actually works.
Sick juggle though.
Choose card.
I don't want to be that guy, but it looks like might be already won by the Paladin.
Yeah, I mean, again, like, what's can't quite see what the card he just drew into was.
I think it's Fury War X.
Okay. Yeah, that doesn't help.
Is
so
it?
Can't really deal with the 7/7.
I mean, he just needs to shield block,
so
right?
Many choices.
No, wait. It's a revenge.
That's revenge change, I think. In theory, you can attack into the 7/7. Did he negate Noble Sacrifice? No, Noble Sacrifice is still there.
Revenge
proxy with 12.
12, right? Oh, so if he like attacked in, even if he could hit the 7/7, it wouldn't be enough to make like the revenge do the rest of the work. There's Noble Sacrifice, Avenge, and Redemption,
yeah,
right?
So it will stop
yeah,
the
so the attack's really awkward. And this is what I was saying earlier. You need the minions on the board to be able to do something. Having just a weapon isn't enough.
Consecration. So much damage.
You just Blessing of Kings and one of the 1/1s, right? And Hero Power.
And just go phase everything.
I think Hoey will just follow his lead that he had made less than. No, I think he would just trade for one of the Shields Maiden, you know?
You think?
Yeah.
I just like going aggressive because worst case he brawls and then like and then you just play Tyrion and go. Okay.
I think it makes sense. Like going for phase is fine as well, but if you just kill right now he probably would just go phase because he could have hit with the knife into the 5/5. But if you just Blessing of Kings one of the 1/1 and kill Shield Maiden, this means the opponent is again in a tough spot where
no, he doesn't. I mean, he was playing first the minion just to see if he's able to trade the Nub Juggler and the 1/1.
Yeah. You always need to see where that juggle goes. It might actually impact the play. And like you said, if that was the case, then maybe he wouldn't just keep the 7/7 and the 5/5 on the board because that's not as susceptible to brawl. And
yes,
he's already
seen
one execute. But this is just still awkward, even with the one minion. Because the problem is he has to like clear the board and gain health somewhere.
Well, it's not that terrible.
Well,
now we can revenge for 3 damage. So you proc the
and
the Big Game Hunter. So you can attack with the weapon first, trade with the, you know, Noble Sacrifice. Oh god, it's getting late. With the Noble Sacrifice, you kill the Navi Juggler after that, and then you trade your Shields Maiden into one of the minions, and your Big Game Hunter the other one. Wait, why would you play the Big Game Hunter now?
Maybe you don't want to have the knife to your face.
But then you... You might kill your own Big Game Hunter.
Yeah, but
and I think it's very important to have it on the board.
Every damage matters, I think.
That's true, but at the same time, you know that Paladin can burst you down, and the Big Game Hunter allows you to save damage next turn, because you can kill whatever will be played on board unless it's
serious. Maybe he actually forgot that Noble Sacrifice is spawning a knife.
Yeah.
Or maybe he just wanted really to just...
Nifwarion!
Nice.
Also, I think just a card True Heart here is huge. Because like he can, like this turn, he can... he's 1 mana off doing
the double hero
power, right? But it's still, like, even just a card Hero Power here starts to put like pull yourself away from lethal.
I think you should go for the shield block even if you plan to play Justicar, because your hand is really dry.
Welcome to the grand tournament.
Yeah, that's true. And it's still like... You need to draw and it gains you the armor, right?
It's so funny that Justicar actually contests the Tyrion, though.
That's the thing. I mean, a lot of people about Justicar at first were like, well, it's got 3 health. And it's like, well, that's okay. And that, you know, we understand why that's not good. But when you, sometimes your opponent can't just do 3 damage to it easily. Sometimes they don't have a small minion to deal with it. And as you can see now, it's got 3 health. But that's irrelevant because it's got 6 attack now. So.
And the gain for the hero power is so warrior.
Yeah, it's crazy, actually.
Alright, so Dr. Boom turn. It's a pretty good card for 7 mana. And just continuing to play pressure. And he probably even has some burst.
And that's redemption. So if he kills Tyrion, he's still gonna get through another one.
Oh my god. That's not useful at all. I mean,
I think it's a good pick at the moment in Warrior, actually. Because if you play, because a lot of Warrior matchups are about the long game with Justicar. And because no one's playing Harrison anymore, Gorehal just like almost infinitely trades.
Maybe everyone heard that Zedalt will be competing here, so they thought, well, it's great a card against Breach.
Yeah. Isn't that it? Like, he has 7 mana, so he can play Plunder and ping something to get a card, but there is 13 damage coming from...
It's the redemption that's the problem.
Yeah, but like, even if there is no redemption, let's say he kills Tyrion, there is 5 damage from Ashbringer. Dr. Boom stays with us, so it's 12. And then you have 4 more, so 60 damage. He's at 13 right now. So I guess he would normally be able to escape it.
That's game.
Yeah. Oh wait, there might be that 0 mana spell that closed the board. We all know about
it. What is the spell though? That's Mind Blast. Not helping, and that's a concede.
And Hoi took 0 points of damage this game. It's crazy.
Flawless victory. Finish it.
And now, Chiyorn is down to his Druid. And that's not a great matchup versus Paladin.
He has Black Knight for Tyrion, though. And the Sludge Belchers, actually. So that might help. The double Sludge Belcher with Black Knight, but...
Sludge Belcher is not the best target, though. Like, it feels bad, man. You kill a 3-5, there's left. A 1-2 left.
I mean, it's still good. It's like 6 mana Yeti that deals... it's like you put -2 and -4 on a minion. Sorry, -2, -3 on a minion.
Yeah.
It's reasonable.
It's reasonable, but still, like, you sometimes just need to hard cast Black Knight without taunts because you need a drop. We'll see, we'll see. Double Shield Amiibo is absolutely great opening for Hoi.
It's hilarious. It's hilarious when
I
see that.
There's some ramp on the Druid side here, and Swipe's actually quite important for those Lusters to play down the board. That's one of the key cards in as Druid against Paladin. But double mini boss also pretty okay stuff.
I mean, it's a good minion for 3 mana even. So you just assume you have a good 2-drop, good 3-drop, 3-drop into great 4-drop, into... You will probably just rip a Belcher some point.
That's how you play this stuff, right? you just curve out and win.
Well, the thing is, with no master, this Aspirant is surviving.
That's really annoying, because I assume that Shenzhen will not destroy both Divine Shield next turn. And that Blessing of Kings is a blessing in disguise, I would say. Because the Divine Shield will just kill whatever minion we played with the help of the ramp for the
Druid.
He could
swipe face this turn. It'll be fine.
Amazing.
Oh, with the drawing the Shred is pretty good.
Yeah, absolutely. It's great.
But again, like, well, they're exposed to a certain extent, the Blessing of Kings, whether he chooses to use it now or not, but the Blessing of Kings and Shredders, well, there's turn 4 and 5, right? Mm-hmm. And now he even draws Redemption.
All right, so you either go Shredder or you go Blessing of Kings and what, go face?
I think just because the Shredder was played instead of Druid of the Claw, you go for the Shredder and kill the Darnassus Aspirant to avoid a 6-drop. Because you know your opponent doesn't have a 5-drop right now, because he opted for the Shredder instead of a 5-drop. So you might take a guess that there will be a 6-drop or maybe an innervate for, let's say, a 7-drop.
And also, next turn, you'd imagine one of the mini-bots will survive, and the Shredders might well survive as well, so because you've got some pretty good minions then, having the 3 on the board versus just the Shredder. Next turn, there's Blessing of Kings Redemption, and when you redemption, chances are mini-bot or Shredder.
Both
of those
crazy.
Are pretty okay.
Yeah.
Either one's good, right?
Yeah. One mana Argent Host Rider without charge? Yeah, that's okay.
So what's the play now? Like, you can have Keeper, but there's a couple of options. You can silence the Shredder and attack with your Shredder into it to have a minion. You can heal the 2-2 with Keeper and a second 2-2 with the Shredder, giving you pretty good value.
Oh, he's going face! Now that's kind of surprising, because I would think that if you kill one of the mini bots with the Keeper, you kill the other one with your Paladin Shredder to make it kind of awkward for the trades, right? But in this situation, because we know that Paladin has a problem with dealing 1 damage, the same as Hunter. But in this situation, it leaves it changes exactly the pace of the game. Because now Hoi is able to trade with the Paladin Shredder into the Keeper and still have 2 great minions for the redemption.
Yeah, because he's probably going to Blessing the Kings to 2-2. And like, this is insane. Because now, like, well, he has to kill one of these minions at least, right? You can't just leave them. I'm going to play around redemption by not killing minions. It's like, well, that's 10 damage a turn, so that's not going to work out very well.
That's a good clock on the Druid player. So.
And here we go. This is the power of Secret Paladin. He's got himself in this situation, and he's follow up his mysterious challenger. It's like, okay.
This is just so insane. Like the curve.
Oh my god.
And Cockhammer's pretty good too. I've heard that's a
You'd
decent
probably
card.
Still go for Mysterious Challenger.
But now he has a turn 7 play.
Yeah.
Well, I'll say turn 7 play. Cockhammer and then Avenge after the attack.
That's a pretty good turn.
It's okay, yeah.
So
it's just that
if you want to have the value from the redemption they already have on board, I think Cockhammer is a reasonable choice here. Because you can just play Cockhammer and go face. And that's it.
You can play
you
Avenge as well.
You deal 12 damage
this
turn.
Yeah, you can drop Avenge as well, yeah.
Yeah, and of course
those should proc, and then you drop Mysterious Challenger, which re-pull your secrets into the deck.
Yeah.
Into the board, sorry.
Another thing is, like, if you just go Mysterious Challenger, then you might actually consider dying there.
This is still nice, though, because, again, it's something I mentioned earlier. He has Mysterious Challenger on the board with two minions as well.
Yeah.
And that's probably not the minion you want to drop out of the Shredder on Shurin's side, because he really needs to do as much as he can to clear this board, and maybe Hero Power is going to be involved. I think it might have to be, but when you're forced into Hero Powering in a turn to make things happen, it's kind of rough.
It might still work. If he Hero Powers now, attack phase, if Avenge lands on the Mysterious Challenger, he will actually be able to kill it with Wrath, Swipe, and minion attack.
Yeah.
That's far-fetched.
Well, it might happen.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's all pretty low cost, right? He's got enough mana, yeah. Yeah, because of the Emperor.
Oh!
Look
at that.
It actually happened.
Look at that.
So now he can attack, and he clears the board with Swipe and Wrath.
This is why I like Cockhammer, you know?
Yeah.
There's so much value.
Yeah,
so much
the thing as well is, it's one of those odd situations that Redemption was better without the other secrets,
yes,
because
exactly.
The two minions you've got down are insane, whereas Redemption is always going to, not always, but most of the time going to hit on the 2-1.
Well, Sludge Belcher is a good follow-up.
I mean, Hoe is still ahead,
yeah.
Like miles ahead of the Druid. Druid is lower on cards, has a useless Wild Grove in his hand.
What's the secret that's left?
That's
Competitive
Spirit.
That's Competitive
yes.
Spirit, yeah, because the minions were cleared. But you know, Hoy is more of a high-risk, high-reward player.
Yeah.
Like, the Cockhammer was a safe play, kind of. You probably had to kill
was
some
it?
Minions as well.
I don't think so, because you just play Cockhammer and do 12 damage.
Well, Mystery's Challenger was a great play if there is no answer to that. And there had to be a specific order of things. Also, like, Avenge landing on one of the minions.
How much do you think the regret of playing that Keeper of the Grove is going to hurt, especially after he's just about to drop Tyrion?
Can you not play that Keeper of the Grove this soon when your hand is dry like that?
True. True. It's still going to hurt.
Shurhan is visibly upset.
Yeah.
Oh.
This is if Hoy 3-0s.
Yeah.
With secret pound in it.
You just draw
again.
So
it's just
well.
Just again. Just
didn't he have three times Tyrion on tonight in a row?
I think so, yeah.
Pretty good curve overall.
Yeah.
He had three
and
times
he's had Mysterious Challenger
three
every
times,
time, right?
Yes,
every time.
Every time Mysterious Challenger on turn 6 and every time Tyrion on turn 8.
Although, you know what we've not seen? I don't think.
Dr.
Bone
was played.
Have we seen Muster?
Yeah, but he had too many Muster.
Oh, yeah. I'm not saying he needed Muster. I just asked if we'd seen it.
Yeah.
Like, he's like, you know what? I've cut Muster.
I think
because I just draw so well, I do not need Muster.
Do you think he maybe cut one?
No, that's no way. That's
I think it's
possible.
I'm going to ask him after the set, but I think it's Charlie Mustard's too good, right? Not to cut.
It
that's
seems
too good.
It seems too good, yeah.
Because as well, in the mirror, if you have Mustard and your opponent doesn't, like you're so far ahead.
You really want the Mustard, yeah, most of the time. But at this moment, he doesn't have lethal yet. And if Sylvanas steals Tyrion...
Yeah, and this is awkward as well, because of the Druid Hero Power and having the Shade as well, even Noble Sacrifice doesn't help with the whole, like, well, just don't kill your Sylvanas, because attacking that way.
He's probably going into Sylvanas now. Yeah, he will kill the Sylvanas on his own terms.
And this takes the so close!
Just the 1-1.
This is why Hoy can win so many.
Yeah, that was a long turn, but Shuyan is really upset. He's not out yet, like, he's undefeated. He's 6-0.
Yeah.
He loses versus Hoy, and then he still has two rounds tomorrow to just win at least once to guarantee the top 16.
Oh, so there's combo. It's just a shame there's two Divine Shield minions on the board
with
Taunt. And then isn't Noble Sacrifice down as well?
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah, because he played it.
Yeah. I mean,
Well, that's a grim spot.
Hoy is a god. That's all I'm saying.
He's really consistent.
I think it's because he shares his colors on his hoodie with Paladin's color.
Yeah, it's colorful. That's why he joined Na'Vi.
Yeah, that's
what
how it
team
goes.
Has yellow? It's Dignitas or Na'Vi.
He's just waiting for.
I don't like bananas, so I'm going to I'm going to Na'Vi. Can't join Chaki in the Mookla cosplay.
Is he cosplaying Mookla? Shots
he did,
fired.
He did before. He was like eating a banana. Right? That was a joke.
So what he's looking for is the Black Knight to decrease the amount of damage by one.
It wouldn't help that much. How much damage is there overall?
Well, at 6, 8, 9, and 12. And it can't attack because because of Enchi, you get killed.
Is it 13? Oh, because of
that's it.
Oh no, it's one off, isn't it?
6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12, 14, 16 damage right now. Just win.
No, it's 15. 15.
Oh, it's 15, late. Yeah, never mind me.
Yeah, I was like, what? I thought it was 15. And yeah, it's 15. Still.
It's still pretty good.
Yeah, when you put the druid to one, and there's still enough Divine Shield and Taunt and the Noble Sacrifice to be like,
you can
you're still not getting through it. You can combo all you want. It's not getting through, right?
You can kill Lothab as well. Like, just consecrate this, attack with the Secret Keeper into Lothab, and the rest is base. That's fine.
Yeah. I mean, because he's so safe versus combo, it's like, yeah, I'll just kill it to be even more safe now, because what can the druid draw? What does he draw?
Druid of the Claw.
No chance to come
that
back
help.
Here.
Can
he survive? Can he survive one more turn?
So he can combo, he can kill Tyrion, he can kill the 1-1.
There will be the weapon.
And
though.
That's it, right? Because of the Noble Sacrifice.
If you just play the taunt, what happens? You soak 6 damage. There's 3, 4, 5, 6.
It's 10. So even with Hero Power, he's dead.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Noble Sacrifice is so big versus Druid. Like, because it just it completely alters the general combo.
Alright, so just going for the motions, doing your best, see what you can do. You obviously have to still a chance. But we know how I have it. With the Ashbringer, maybe 6 and 5, 7. Actually, not yet. Actually, not this turn.
That's lethal, right? He has 4, and then the 2 1-1s. So, yeah, you'll trade the 4-3 in there, and then it's 3, 4, 5.
Oh, yeah, because the consecration actually deals damage to face. Alright, so Hoy takes the series 3-0. Incredible and really consistent win. Xiaoyu played really well. Really well. I didn't see any specific mistakes, I think. And, well, he's here with 6-0. And I have, like, full belief he's actually going to make it to top 16. And I want to make... I want to see him in top 16 because he flew all the way from China. And he's supposed to be one of the best Chinese players.
Mm-hmm.
So this is his big tournament, his big moment to actually shine here at DreamHack Winter 2015.
Yeah, and I really want to see more of his Warrior deck as well, because we saw like Nexus Champions Herald, we saw Nefarian, the Gore Howl. So it's really interesting sort of take on the deck.
By
so
interesting, you mean greedy.
Greedy, yeah.
It is greedy.
But it's doing well, right? It's doing well. It's
greedy
just
is good.
It's just, and we've just seen the power of Secret Paladin. So we were talking earlier about what we think the best deck in the game is, and like, I was just like Secret Paladin full stop. And like that's why, because like on you just saw like yes, like Hoy drew really well, but like on curve that deck is just almost unbeatable. It's so powerful.
It's really good. We still have a second game running because Purple is still fighting JJ. So we are going to show this game in just a moment. They're also undefeated, 6-0 for both of them. We've seen JJ first round, he won versus AK Wonder. We've seen Purple just have really convincing win versus Powder, a 3-0 with his Malygos Warlock.
I hope he's not played it or he's still playing it. I want to see more of that Malygos
Warlock. It's still alive, right?
I was speaking to some of the players earlier while I wasn't casting about Malygos, and there's a good chunk of players that are like, I might bring that to the next tournament I go to, because like, that deck is actually pretty good. Because Purple's record with that Warlock is along the same line as Hoy's with his Paladin. He's just destroyed everyone with it. It's incredible.
It's very interesting. I would like to see more of that deck. And I mean, it's always fun to watch decks that have 30 different cards.
Warlock
is dead.
Aww. No. So there's Druid and Warrior, and it looks like Druid versus Warrior at the moment. And then, oh, they both have Druid Warrior. That threw me off for a second. Oh, it's right. Just starting as well. Good timing.
Druid Warrior, Warrior, and that's the Patron third game. It's a 1-1. Okay. Everything's clear. So the winner will be guaranteed top 16. He will still continue playing because we have 9 rounds total. Yep. But with 7 wins, you are just 100% top 16.
Yeah.
Even if you lose 2 last games, you are 7-2.
And the tiebreaker as well. Yeah, that's the main thing. Like, the reason you pretty certain to get through is because your tiebreak is so high. You've lost to someone who's 6-0.
Yeah.
So, like, that's pretty incredible. But Patron Mirror, this is something we've not, or at least I've not cast in a while, to be honest.
This will be a long match.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. No, wait. There's a Patron in a rage. That's fine.
Maybe.
Never mind, because that feels like a
there's
end
double
of the
execute
game already.
Though. Okay.
That's so much resources.
That's something, right?
What else are you executing in Patron?
And with Acolyte? That's a really a mirror match here. But I think actually Purple is playing more minion-based version. JJ is playing the draw one with 1 shield block, double Gnomish Inventor. And Purple, I think he's playing the Shredder Belcher one, but I'm not sure entirely.
Okay.
Please someone tell Purple that he will go bald very fast if he'll be doing that every single time he plays.
Yeah, that's not good. That's a lot of hair pulling.
He's actually quite stressed, right?
No, it's just like... He's always doing that. I think that's a stress
thing.
It's just like, yeah, his
Although if we go back to Purple's match versus Powder, which was pretty funny, because Purple was just straight up staring at him over the tablet. He seems a little bit more, not so much, I don't want to say focused, but a little bit more like intense on his own play as opposed to trying to stare at his opponent.
Guys, are we going to have a third world effect? Because he just picked up Warrior. It's like...
Oh, and he's got... Yeah, next turn.
Enrage, Ghoul, Whirlwind, Death Spy. Like, do you even need all those Whirlwind effects?
I don't think so.
I mean... This is a tough one, actually, because he kind of needs to kill the Ghoul. Because it's turn 5, and you have to expect it, right? With Ghoul and, like, the second charge of Death Spy hanging around on your opponent's side, you sort of have to expect the Patron turn.
Yeah, but...
So he kind of... I mean, I...
How do you do it, though?
I mean, he can just deathbite it down. It looks terrible.
Is there any merit in, like, killing Acolyte of Pain as well? Probably not.
Well, he could... The problem is, he could, like, in a rage the Ghoul.
Well,
and then deathbite, but it's...
Can you throw away Whirlwinds? Just throw away Whirlwinds, kill both of that, and just maybe just play a minion?
I think this is okay.
Yeah, it's fine.
So what he can do now, depending on how many patrons are spawned, is that he can execute patrons. Say just 2 patrons spawn, right? He can execute 1 and then just freely deathbite it. If more are spawned, then he does have double execute, but that depends how much he wants to really commit. And he has the inner rage for like to kill the one house,
yeah.
Right? So there are he does have answers, but it's whether it'll cost him too much in terms of answers.
Still so good for Purple. No brawl for JJ. And then another Whirlwind effect, which means that there is, what, 6 patrons on board?
And the thing is as well, this now no longer can be punished. The answer to this used to be the Frothing Berserker, because your opponent's giving you the amount of minions you need to do the big charge attack. And that's not going to happen, so this matchup's actually more heavily decided by getting the turn 5 Patron Dream.
Is there any way to like use the 7 minions on board to somehow clear more of them?
It's going to be tough without charge, though, isn't it? Because he could, like, in a rage one, then whirlwind, but I just don't think it does enough, and his death bite's always going to cause a problem. Because this leaves... Yeah, this is still just an issue.
Yeah.
Because there's still 1 space for a patron to spawn, right?
Yes, exactly.
So, like, the ghoul dying... just helps your opponent still. If he'd left the board full, then that's different because the ghoul effect won't spawn another patron. Oh, okay.
But it kills 2 patrons, so there's still place.
Oh, yeah.
That's even worse because now he has 2 spaces. He actually made it worse by playing the Whirlwind. And
now
this puts exactly the same situation again on board.
Yeah, JJ's actually just shaking his head. He's like,
There's like no way to deal with all those dwarves.
Yeah. Oh, wait, that was the final game. Was it? No.
Oh. It looks like it. Okay. No, maybe we didn't get the score. So we'd seen Super JJ's Druid, I guess, lose.
Maybe they haven't finished. Maybe they're like just hugging each other after the pace.
Oh, JJ went, I'm so stressed after so many whirlwind effects on that board and not still clearing the patrons. I'm done. Take the win.
Okay, so this means that purple.
I guess purple won.
Yeah, purple won. Yeah. Purple is undefeated and purple is top
16. People will be playing against Hoey next game. No, we have to get another.
Yeah, I think there's still more.
Right?
Yeah, there's still more.
We will have four players with 7-0s.
But there's still a chance he could play.
There's a great chance that he will actually play.
I hope he does, actually. I want to see Purple versus Hoi.
That would be a pretty
That'll
good
be a
match.
Sick match.
But tomorrow we'll have like a lot of matches, which are elimination matches as well. Because after 7 rounds, we'll have a lot of 5-2s. Mm-hmm. And those 5-2s, if they lose at least once, they're out. So we'll have a lot of pro players and aspiring pro players actually facing each other in a situation where it's like life and death. It's like you win, you have a chance to actually advance to top 16. If you lose, you're kind of out. So a lot of things will happen tomorrow because two more rounds of Swiss will happen and then top 16. And on the third day, on Saturday, we'll have the top 8. And, well, that was an amazing day, guys.
Yeah, it was a long day of amazing games. 7 rounds of Swiss. And from what I can judge from the players that are like after the 7 rounds, you can see that there's, of course, there's space to say that Hearthstone has RNG factor in it, and it's a huge one. But at the same time, the better players are prevailing in such a huge amount of rounds. So I'm really excited to see the top 16 after tomorrow.
Yeah, and this absolutely. Is why Swiss is so good as well, because I think Swiss is probably the best format to give an overall, you know, consistent. Good players should go far in a Swiss format because it's not like single limb. Obviously, anyone can lose a set of Hearthstone versus anyone. That's just the way the game works sometimes. But over so many rounds, you if you're consistently decent and good, then like the sort of, oh, I've drew bad this game, that sort of gets less and less important.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, guys, I think that's more or less done. We had a really long day, 7 rounds of Swiss, 2 more tomorrow. We had some players eliminated and a lot of really great consistent players are with almost perfect score right now. So hopefully they will keep playing and keep winning and we'll see them in the top 16 as well. Tomorrow we start, I think, at the same time, which is 10 a.m. in the morning. It's actually 11 p.m.
11. Yeah, 11.
11 p.m. for the broadcast.
11 a.m.
11? 1 a.m.?
No, 11 a.m. because you said p.m.
11 a.m., yes. Yeah.
11:15 a.m.
Okay, so 11:15 for the pre-show. Yeah. That's the start. And for today, I think that's it. It was a really good day, a really great tournament. We have more Hearthstone action. So thank you so much for watching. Stay tuned for more tomorrow from me, from Lothar, from Raven, and from Froden, who's on the break right now. Thanks.